Okay. Thank you everyone for joining us tonight. My name is Maura Boudreau. I do programs and publicity for the West Hartford Public Library. We're here today to talk with Carol Emberton about her book, To Walk About in Freedom, The Long Emancipation of Priscilla Joyner. And she is joining us from Buffalo via Zoom. This meeting is being recorded. So tomorrow I will go in the office and I will edit it and forward it out and you can watch it at your leisure, or if anyone missed it, they can watch it then. If you do have any questions, what you can do is put them in the chat box to the lower right-hand corner, and Carol will be able to answer the questions at the end of the presentation. Let me give an introduction to Carol, and then I will turn it over to her. Carol is a historian and writer focusing on the American South. A native of Kentucky, she grew up with a keen awareness of the racial dividing lines operating around her, but unsure of how or why they existed. She spent much of her life trying to figure them out. Her work explores the traumatic histories of race and violence in the American past. Her first book, Beyond Redemption, revealed how the protracted violence of the Civil War shaped Americans' understanding of citizenship and national belonging, giving rise to a political culture that embraced violence as a necessary crucible of freedom. Her latest book, To Walk About in Freedom, The Long Emancipation of Priscilla Joyner, explores the lived experiences of freedom's charter generation, the people who were born in slavery, but who came of age during the tumultuous period of war and Reconstruction. Her writing on these and other issues related to racial politics in America have appeared in the New York Times and Washington Post, among other outlets. She is currently a professor of history at the University of Buffalo. As a first-generation college student, the success of this important but often overlooked group on America's campuses is close to her heart. She is thrilled to be part of the University of Buffalo's Proud to Be First initiative to connect, support, and guide first-generation students in their college journey. And with that, I will turn it over to Carol.
Thank you so much, Maura. Thank you for inviting me. And thanks to everyone out there for spending part of your evening here with me while I talk about my latest research and the life of Priscilla Joyner, which I think you will really enjoy. And first, as you can see from my presentation here, I'm going to try to convince you that this book should be banned, right? We're in the midst of sort of a book banning frenzy, it seems, here in the United States for the past couple of years, but it's really sort of ratcheted up recently. And there's a lot of concern and debate and argumentation about the way that history is taught, particularly in the K-12 environment, but also in college classrooms, which is, of course, where I teach. And these conversations and debates go directly to the heart central questions about American history and how it's taught and how we know what we know and what it is that historians like me do. So that is sort of the broader sort of background that is informing, you know, my talk this evening. And I want you to think about, you know, how history is created, how our historical knowledge comes to be, and what it means to really think about the creation of historical knowledge and the role that historians like myself play in that. So, as I was saying, and as most of you are, I'm sure, aware, many, many states have proposed some kind of legislative ban on anti-racist teaching and trainings in the workplaces and in schools. You know, this is particularly, you know, something of you know, our current moment. And I think it speaks to a broader discomfort in our public culture about questions of race and racial discrimination. And the history of those topics as well. In my own state here in New York, there is a bill currently before the New York State Assembly that prohibits, or that we've passed, would prohibit the teaching of any of the following concepts. In particular, it wants to limit or ban individuals, anything that makes individuals feel discomfort, guilt, anguish, or any other form of psychological distress on account of his or her race or sex. And I think this really sort of gets to the heart of what bothers a lot of people about some of these topics being taught in our school system is that, you know, they stir up a lot of uncomfortable feelings. And in classes where these topics are taught, because I've been there at both as a student and as an instructor, you have difficult conversations sometimes, and feelings are, you know, difficult to try to parse through and deal with. But as I tell my students in class all the time, history is not meant to make you feel comfortable or to make you feel good. History is about informing ourselves and facing the realities of the past head on. And if you're taking history classes and all those history classes do is make you feel good about yourself, about your country, make you feel happy, make you feel joyous, then you're not really getting the full story, right? And you're being actually, I think, shortchanged. So you've probably also heard about critical race theory. You've heard that term mentioned. You may not be entirely familiar with what that is. You know, it's a field of legal studies that emerged in law schools a couple of decades ago. But there are some basic principles, I think, of critical race theory that make people particularly uncomfortable about the way that it's infused the teaching of American history. The first being that the system, whether it's the legal system, the economic system, the political system in the United States, is not broken. Racism is not evidence of sort of a momentary, you know, lapse or mistake. Those systems are entrenched with racism, and they have had racist premises sort of built in from the beginning. Even good people are implicated in these systems of racial oppression, and proponent or people who study and write about critical race theory, they don't talk about necessarily as individual people, good guys and bad guys. They're really talking about these much, much larger systems that we are all implicated in and that we are all working and living and operating in, whether we like it or not. And finally, and this is the one I really am going to focus on this evening in introducing you to my research, is that the legacies of slavery are still with us. And this is really central to my work, and particularly the life of Priscilla Joyner, who I'm going to talk about here in a little bit. She was a woman who was born in 1858 in North Carolina. Her status, whether she was enslaved or not, we're going to get to the sort of the complicated question of that in just a moment, but she was a Black child who was living in a slave state of North Carolina at the time. She lives through the Civil War. She lived through Reconstruction, through Jim Crow, and she died in 1944. And throughout those 8 decades of her life, she lived with and struggled against the legacies of slavery that still attempted to hold her, her husband, her children, her neighbors, in a kind of bondage, even though legal emancipation had taken place many, many decades earlier. So this is Priscilla Joyner. This is one of the few photographs that exist of her. And it was taken on a day in the late 1930s when members of the Federal Writers Project arrived at her home to interview her. And the Federal Writers Project was a New Deal organization created by President Roosevelt during the Great Depression to employ, out of work editors, teachers, writers, people like that, cultural workers. And they went around a lot of what the Federal Writers Project did. They had many projects, but one of their biggest projects was interviewing everyday Americans and taking down the life stories of everyday people. And Priscilla Joyner and at approximately 2,000 or so formerly enslaved people were also a part of this Life Histories project. So at the time Priscilla Joyner, I mentioned she'd been born in North Carolina, but at the time she was living in Suffolk, Virginia, and she was interviewed by field workers who were sort of fanning out across Virginia to locate formerly enslaved people and interview them about their life. What had their experiences been like? What did they remember about slavery? You know, what did they know about or what did they witness during the Civil War? What was life like after slavery was over? These kinds of questions were what they were interested in. And this is how I came across Priscilla Joyner's interview. That's how I got started on this journey. I was reading these interviews of formerly enslaved people. And I came across Priscilla Joyner's interview and I was really blown away by it. In large part because she was talking about the hold that slavery continued to have on her life despite her, you know, struggles against it, despite all the legal revolutions, political revolutions that happened in the wake of the Civil War. She still personally, you know, as an individual and members of her family, still struggled mightily against that shadow of slavery for her entire life. Now, the story, the interview that Priscilla Joyner gave was used to write, along with the other interviews by Virginia ex-slaves, used to write a book about the history of Virginia from the perspective of the state's Black people. The book was called, it was titled The Negro in Virginia. It's still available. You can probably get it from the library and read about it. But that book was such it was not only a historical project, but it was also a political project because it was attempting to retell the history, not just of the state of Virginia, but really all of American history from the perspective of Black people, using their voices, using their experiences, making those experiences central to the telling of that history. This book was published in the early 1940s. This was one of the first attempts to try to do that kind of revisionist history, that rewriting of history. And so there were some people who were very skeptical about this project and who tried to limit, in particular, Priscilla Joyner's contribution to that larger project. And that's what I'm going to talk about. So I've already mentioned, you know, the Federal Writers Project. It was part of the New Deal in the 1930s. It was one of the first federally funded public history projects in the United States. The Federal Writers Project, they wrote, they went to, you know, local courthouses all over the United States. They cataloged, you know, old papers, manuscripts. They wrote histories of every single United state in the United States at the time, and they collected these life histories. They were particularly wanted to capture the experiences of the people they referred to as the resourceful, unembittered men and women who were coping with social disaster. Of course, the social disaster they were talking about at that moment was the Great Depression. But in interviewing formerly enslaved people, they were, of course, talking about a much longer history of social disaster, of slavery and civil war and the post-war period. And they really wanted to capture the details of survival, the perseverance, the spirit of persistence that they felt the everyday men and women in the United States represented. Initially, when these life story, interviews first began, the leaders of the Federal Writers Project were really skeptical that ex-slaves had anything of value to offer. They believed that they, you know, they were too mired in the past and whatever they had to say was going to focus on the past, on slavery. And so they directed the interviewers who were going out into the field to be sure to steer them away from topics like slavery. We don't want to talk about that. That's really depressing. You know, this is not going to be the kind of uplifting stories we want to tell. They advise interviewers to focus on what they called exceptional people, people who had, you know, achieved a level of social mobility, who had risen up the social ladder, who had become middle class, or perhaps, you know, business owners, teachers, people like that, who were exceptional. They didn't necessarily want to hear from someone like Priscilla Joyner, who was, she was not illiterate, but she didn't have much of an education. Both she and her husband were solidly working class people. They didn't have a lot in the way of economic resources. At the end of her life, Priscilla Joyner, you know, sort of made a living growing and selling flowers, right? The people who were crafting these projects initially really wanted these interviews and the projects, you know, the books that were going, that they hoped would come from them, to really appeal to white readers. And so they figured white readers in the 1930s and 40s wanted to hear uplifting stories. They wanted to hear stories that made them feel good. They didn't want to hear anything that was going to perhaps, and this is again linking back to what I talked about before, anything that was going to make them feel bad about themselves or guilty or down or anything like that. Okay. So enter Sterling Brown. And Sterling Brown was a poet, a kind of realist poet from the Harlem Renaissance. He was a professor of English at Howard University. And he is given the job of supervising, overseeing the ex-slave narratives. And he was one of the early people who are proponents of interviewing ex-slaves and really pushed the writer's project to include ex-slaves in these first-person narratives. And he believed that ex-slaves were guardians of Southern folk culture. He was, as a poet, he had traveled around the South himself, and he was really interested in collecting vernacular expression. He was interested in the way people talked and the way Southern Black people describe things and their folk expression. And as he's getting the transcripts of these interviews in his office back in Washington, D.C., and he's reading the kind of interviews and the kind of questions that these interviewers, who by and large are mostly white, they're not entirely, they're mostly white though, are asking formerly enslaved people, he realized that they are trying to sort of project this moonlight and magnolias picture of the South and of slavery, and trying to basically get these elderly Black people, most of them are in their 70s, 80s, or sometimes even their 90s at the time, to sort of confirm for them their own biases they have about the South, right? That the South was this sort of beautiful romantic civilization where prior to the Civil War, everything was beautiful, everyone got along. Yes, there were slaves, but they were well taken care of and they were happy and content, right? And so at one point, Sterling Brown writes to his supervisor, you know, he's sort of exasperated, having read all of these interviews done, you know, pretty badly. And he talks about how in these manuscripts, the Old South lingers on, right? And that's what he is trying to battle. He is trying to, you know, give instructions and get these interviewers and the state level supervisors to really sort of, you know, rein this in and hopefully rewrite American history from the Black point of view, an authentic point of view, not one that is shaped and sort of created by white people. Now in Virginia, the state level Virginia Writers Project, which again is part of the Federal Writers Project, like, well, really all of the state level directors, in Virginia, it was a white woman. Her name was Eudora Ramsey Richardson. She was from a very well-to-do family. She was a white editor and supervisor as you know, they were in all of the other states. But in Virginia, the really interesting thing is all the field workers, and there it varied. There were sometimes 10, sometimes 12 or so field workers who were going out and doing these interviews. They in Virginia, they were all Black. And Virginia is the only state that has sort of an all-Black field crew doing these interviews. There are quite a few. There are some Black interviewers in Florida and one or two here in some of the other states. But Virginia is really the only one with their whole team of field workers, interviewers are African-American. And her other job is to edit the manuscript that these Black field workers are going to be producing of that book I mentioned that Priscilla Joyner is a part of, The Negro in Virginia. Richardson herself was a published biographer. She had written a biography of the vice president of the Confederacy, Alexander Hamilton Stevens. She considered herself a progressive. She was in favor of woman suffrage. She was a suffragist. She felt that she was enlightened on issues relating to women and race as well. But she also saw herself as a guardian of Virginia's noble heritage. And she was very alert when she's, you know, reading these interview transcripts, when she's reading the manuscript of The Negro in Virginia. She's very attuned to anything that casts Virginia's reputation in a negative light. She believed that these Black field workers who were going out and doing these interviews were too deferential and too sympathetic to the ex-slave narrators that they are interviewing. She believed that ex-slaves were unreliable, that they exaggerated the negative aspects of slavery, and that, you know, so she felt that it was her job to sort of correct the stories that they were telling. So it shouldn't really be a surprise to us that when Priscilla Joyner appears in The Negro in Virginia, despite the fact that her interview is one of the more lengthy ones taken from ex-slaves in Virginia, her contribution or her testimony is reduced to this single quotation in The Negro in Virginia. And according to that book, if you opened it up and you found her the page here, Priscilla Joyner said, "My old mistress was the best woman in the world. She brought me up just like one of her own children until I was 12 years old. Then she paid for me to go to a colored school with my own people." But when you go and look at the existing records of Priscilla's interview, nowhere in those papers does she say this. Nowhere does she say this. So this is Eudora Ramsey Richardson. Let's go back and look at Eudora. This is Eudora Ramsey Richardson's rendition of Priscilla Joyner's interview, where she's saying that her old mistress was the best woman in the world and brought her up just like one of her own children. And of course, this sort of glorifies the Southern past, and it legitimates those old stories about the slave South, in which plantation owners and slave mistresses, you know, were kind and caring and took wonderful care of the people that they owned. So just like Sterling Brown said, right, the old South lingers on. So what did Priscilla Joyner really say in her interview? We'll get to that in just a second. But first, I want to bring your attention to the 1860 census that I found when Priscilla Joyner was 2 years old. And Priscilla Joyner, at the time, in 1860, she's 2 years old, she is living in the household of a man named Rick Joyner and his wife, Ann Liza, and their other three children, two daughters and an 8-month-old son. Now, for those of you who have done census research before, this, you know, probably looks somewhat familiar to you. So, you know, the column right next to the names of the individuals, those are their ages, 30, 23, 5, 4, 2, and 8 months. The next column is their sex, male or female. So you see M, F, 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 M, M, male. The third column there is for race. And in the 1860 census, there were three options for race: W for white, B for black, and M for mulatto. Now, Rick's Joyner and Annalisa, Morning Margaret, and Robert, they're all white. Oh, W doesn't appear in their column because white was just the default category. And so the enumerators, when they're writing all this down, they rarely take the time to write the W. It's just understood that if nothing is there, if that column is blank beside a person's name, that they are white. The B for black was typically reserved for enslaved people or people who had really dark skin. And again, this is all based upon the observation of the enumerator. So it's entirely subjective. But if you saw someone in the census who had a B for black, they had, according to that enumerator, they looked like they had really dark skin. M, mulatto, designated someone who the enumerator assumed was of mixed race, meaning that to his eyes, they had a lighter shade of dark skin, right? And again, it's all subjective. Someone could look, you know, light skin to another person, dark skin to another person. But according to this enumerator, Priscilla is listed in the column there where everybody else is blank, they're white. She is listed as M from mulatto. So she is a mixed race child living in a white household. So this is really strange. And in fact, I looked through the entire 1860 for Nash County, North Carolina, which is where they were living at the time. And there's no other family that I could find like this, where there is a white child sharing the same last name, living in the household of a white family. There were indentured servants, black children who were living with white families. But out in this fourth column where it says farmer for Ricks, those children were all designated as servants and they all had different last names. Okay. They were free children, but they had been apprenticed out, bound out as indentured servants to white families. So you do find things like that, but that's not what we have here. Priscilla is listed as one of Rick's and Ann Liza's child. But I can guarantee you both Rick's and Ann Liza are white. So if there is a mixed race child living in their household, the question obviously becomes, whose child is she? Is she Ann Liza's child? Is she Rick's child? She's obviously not white. So there's something unusual, something going on here. What is it? Well, what does Priscilla actually have to say about this in her interview? So in her interview, she's never entirely clear herself. She said, this is the story as Miss Ann Liza, my mother, she said she was, told me after I'd grown up a bit. She says, it seems my mother took up with a colored man. She never would say who it was. And she said the colored people knew all about it and wanted to take care of me in the quarters, meaning the slave quarters or the black neighborhood. But my mother refused, told them that I was her baby and she was going to raise me herself. And when Mr. Ricks Joyner returned to the plantation house, he had been gone for several months. He had actually, according to the story that Ann Liza tells Priscilla, he had sold the only two slaves that she had that were given to her in her marriage by her father. He had sold them without her permission. And she told him basically, get out and don't come back until you bring me those two people back or you bring me the money for them. So Rick's is sort of a ne'er-do-well kind of guy. They have this farm that's given to them by Annalise's father, but he, you know, doesn't seem to care much about farming. He sells her Annalise's property without her permission, so she kicks him out. So he's gone for an extended period of time. And this, according to the story that Priscilla tells in her interview, is when she becomes involved with a Black man. She doesn't say who it was. We don't know if he was enslaved or if he was free. And there was a fairly sizable free Black population in North Carolina at the time. But then eventually, Ricks comes back. He finds this Black baby, this mixed race baby that his wife has given birth to. And according to Priscilla, from what I've heard, she says later, those must have been troublous days, as we can imagine, right? A white man comes home to find that his wife has given birth to a mixed race child. But again, throughout the interview, she's very careful to make sure that the interviewer understands that she's only telling them what Annalise told her. She says, I really don't know who my parents were, but Miss Annalise claimed me and made me call her mother. So Priscilla Joyner is giving this interview in the late 1930s. She's approaching her 80th year. And this question of who her parents were, what her origins are, where she belongs, who are her family, has haunted her, has stayed with her all of these years. And when I talk about sort of the legacy of slavery staying with Priscilla and shaping the rest of her life, this is what I'm talking about. And this is these are the kinds of issues, this is the kind of quandary, this is the kind of trauma that Priscilla endured and many, many others of the Charter generation endured along with her. And this was something that no kind of legal restitution, the right to vote, the Emancipation Proclamation, any of that stuff that we usually think of as markers of freedom, could really rectify or remedy for these people. Who am I? Who are my parents? Where do I belong? These were the questions that stayed with Priscilla. And this is what she talks about when the interviewers come to her house and say, tell us about slavery. Tell us about your life. What did it mean to be free? How did it feel to be free? These are the stories that she talks about. Now, the reason that Priscilla seems sort of hesitant to say whether or not she believes Annalise was her biological mother. She said, Miss Annalise made me call her mother. She claimed to be my mother, but I don't really know. This is not an uncommon feeling or an uncommon situation for formerly enslaved people to be in. It was not unusual for slave-owning white women, like the woman you see here in this picture, to sort of take a very young enslaved child, usually a girl, but not always, as a kind of personal servant or pet. And that's often what they called them, sort of their pet. And they would take the child when it was very young, when it was a toddler, 3 or 4 years old, they would take the child away from its mother, bring the child to live in the main house with them, and sort of raise them as a personal servant. They would give them sometimes special favors. They would give them nicer clothes to wear, hand-me-downs from their own children or things that they had found. And you can see here, this little girl that's standing behind this woman in this picture, you know, she looks like she is wearing what might be a, you know, it's not the typical sort of rough cotton calico dress that you often see enslaved children photographed in at this time. She's wearing something with a print. It looks like it's sort of, to me anyway, like it's kind of hanging on her, like it's maybe a bit too big. So maybe this is a hand-me-down from one of this woman's daughters that she has given this girl to wear. they ply these children with treats and with special favors. They give them extra food to eat. They give them sweet treats, candy, cakes, things like that, as a way to capture the child's affection and to alienate them from their own family, their own mothers, and to become sort of like a surrogate mother or a mother figure to these child. And it's a way to manipulate and exploit the vulnerability of these children, but also the power of the slave owning woman to do this, right? She has the power to do that. She can just take a child, bring it into the house. You know, the child often sleeps on the floor next to the woman during the night in case she needs a glass of water or anything in particular. So they keep these children very close to them. They limit their conversation, their interaction with other enslaved people on the place. They want to make sure they're keeping these children close. They're shaping their reality, their worldview, and they're manipulating those emotional attachments. So it's possible, it is entirely possible that this is what Anna Liza was doing with Priscilla. It wouldn't have been unusual. She's a slaveholding white woman. She comes from a slaveholding family, not a particularly prosperous family, but a slaveholding family nonetheless. And it's clear from Priscilla's interview that even if Ann Liza was her biological mother, the kind of mothering she gave her, you know, didn't clear up any of these questions in Priscilla's mind. Priscilla, the other Joyner children, the two older girls, Margaret and Mourning, and then the younger boy, Robert, and then in 1863, another boy is born to the family. They do not accept Priscilla as their sister. They make fun of her. They torment her. And a lot of it is at the encouragement or from the encouragement of their father, Ricks, who also doesn't accept Priscilla in the household. And the children are cruel to Priscilla. They won't let her play with them. They alienate her. And eventually, as the children are getting bigger, particularly the boys, they start being physically aggressive and violent towards her. And Anna Liza doesn't appear to be able to do anything about this. Eventually, when after the war, Ricks is killed in the war, and when Priscilla is about 12 years old, so around 1870, she sends her to live with a Black family in a nearby town and go to a freedman's school. And that is the last time that Priscilla actually lives in Ann Liza's household. But again, it's not entirely clear that exactly what Ann Liza's actual relationship to Priscilla was she her biological mother? That is entirely possible. It was not unheard of for white women to have mixed race babies, mixed race children. It was much more common in the colonial and early 19th century. As slavery became more entrenched in the 19th century, it became less common, but it still happened. So it's entirely possible she could be Ann Liza's biological child, but it is also possible that she is not, and that she has been sort of co-opted by Anna Liza to be her pretend child. So that is the mystery that is at the center of Priscilla's life. And it's the one that sort of, again, stays with her. She always wants to know who her father is. And on Ann Liza's deathbed, and I believe she dies in 1916, Priscilla goes to her and she begs Ann Liza one final time to tell her who her father was, and Ann Liza refuses. And for Priscilla, this is yet another, this continues to raise the questions in her mind. Does this woman really care for me? Is this woman really my mother? Why won't she tell me after all this time has passed? Who my father is? Why won't she help me figure out, you know, where I came from? Annalisa still maintains that power and refuses to relinquish it even on her deathbed all of those years later. So this is the central problem for Priscilla. This is what shapes her life. This leaves a huge hole in her life that she's never able to fill. And other members of the Charter Generation who are interviewed by the Federal Writers Project in the 1930s echo this kind of loneliness, this emptiness, this not knowing who your parents were, the strained relationships with parents, with family members, and with the people who had once owned them. The record is full. And when people are talking about their personal histories, their life histories, these are the stories that they recall. These are the stories that they tell that have really shaped their lives. And that's what I wrote about in the book. I wanted to end with this painting by Winslow Homer, which is one of my all-time favorites. And it really gets to the heart of the question of why did I write this book? Why did I choose to, you know, spend 10 years of my life researching and piecing together Priscilla Joyner's story and writing this book for you to read? This painting, The Cotton Pickers, was painted in 1876, so some years after the Civil War. And on, you know, the most basic level, it shows, at least in economic terms, how little has changed over the course of the Civil War and Reconstruction for rural Black Southerners, right? They're still primarily agricultural workers, and in the cotton planting areas of the Deep South, they're still planting and harvesting cotton. But what really captures me and captures my imagination in this painting and really captured my, you know, desire in writing this book and my reasons for writing this book are the looks on these two young women's faces. The woman there on the left, you know, her hand is sort of touching the cotton. She seems like she's sort of daydreaming. Her mind is elsewhere. She's obviously doing her job, but she's thinking about something else, right? Her mind is elsewhere. What's she thinking about? What is on her mind? And the woman next to her is sort of looking off into the distance. Again, what is she thinking about? And this to me really, you know, Winslow Homer has captured the fact that despite the hardships, these women and all rural Black Southerners and ex-slaves had dreams, they had desires, they had inner lives that we and that the historical record have rarely made us privy to. The extraordinary thing about these interviews, the one that Priscilla Joyner did and the ones that the thousands of other ex-slaves did for the Federal Writers Project, is that they give us a glimpse into those inner lives, those dreams, those desires, those feelings, the hopefulness that the Charter Generation had as they walked out, right, of slavery and began to walk about in freedom, which of course is the title of the book. So I hope, you know, this talk has given you an idea of what I write about in the book, and hopefully it has inspired you to go and read about Priscilla Joyner and some of the other people that I talk about in the book, other members of the Charter Generation. So thank you very much. And if there are questions, we can answer those now.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much, Carol. There is a question. Can you go back to the census for a moment?
Sure. There we go.
So it says, I'm not sure if this is a typo, but why are Morning and Margaret Joyner listed as the same age? It doesn't appear that way on the census if I'm reading it correctly.
Oh yeah, that's my mistake. So sorry about that.
Okay. So she's six.
Yeah, so on the census, it says Morning is 5 and Margaret is 4.
Oh, 4. Oh, okay.
Yeah. So there is 1 year between them.
Okay.
Why that keeps popping up there? Sorry. So yeah, so my mistake. I transcribed that incorrectly.
Okay. And I think you might have already answered this, but I'm going to ask it anyway.
Okay.
Does Priscilla feel that as a child, she was then treated as a servant or as a child of the Joyners in the same way as the other children?
She definitely feels that she's treated differently. She's treated differently by Ricks, who never accepts her. And she actually says at one point in her interview that she doesn't think he ever spoke a word to her, right? She can't remember him ever speaking directly to her, but she does recall him encouraging the other children to tease her, to taunt her, not to let them play with her, you know, and to sort of treat her as an outsider. So she definitely does not feel to be a part of the family in the same way. She does recall her mother used to, you know, she would be upset at night because of the way she was being treated by the other children. And she said, Aunt Eliza would come in my room and she would sit with me and I would cry and she would hold me and tell me everything was going to be okay. So it does appear that she has some memory of Aunt Eliza trying to offer her some kind of comfort. But she definitely feels like an outcast, an outsider in this household, at least to the way she's treated by Ricks and the way she's treated by the other children.
When I was a youngster, I used to love the Joel Chandler Harris stories and the Disney film Song of the South. I understand that the film is no longer made available, but the books are. I am confused as to what is politically correct and what is not when it comes to the Joel Chandler Harris stuff. Can you clarify?
Yeah, so Joel Chandler Harris, for those of you who aren't familiar, he was a Southern writer, and he wrote these tales of Uncle Remus, who was a character who was enslaved. And if you've ever seen the movie Song of the South or clips from the Disney film Song of the South, which I believe was around 1940, the early 1940s, and you can actually find clips of it on YouTube if you want to look. Uncle Remus is the main character. This is a, you know, Disney-fied version. It's, partially animated with some live action in it. And it's really sort of the song of the South. And it's the song, you know, of sort of the happy, contented slave. That is what Uncle Remus, both in the Harris stories and in the Disney movie, sort of represented, right? He's this very sort of jolly old man who tells all these, you know, sort of funny and, you know, somewhat wry and wise tales. And, you know, you just get, it's a general sense, it's this picture of the romantic South and this vision of sort of the lost cause of the slave South as this very idyllic, civilization where, you know, enslaved people are obviously there, but they're very happy. They're treated very well. And, you know, everyone gets along and everything is happy. You know, academic historians like myself, I mean, people have been writing against that narrative and that vision of the South for a long, long time. And generally, you know, we recognize that, you know, the Uncle Remus stories were incredibly popular in the late 19th century, not only in the South, but among, you know, Northerners as well, because it was a comforting image of the Old South. And it allowed people to sort of forget or not deal with the horrors of slavery and the way, not only, you know, during slavery, but the way, you know, Black Southerners were being treated in the 1880s and the 1890s during the rise of Jim Crow. So it's this very glossy myth. It's a myth, really. So people, you know, have grown up on them, people enjoy them, but it is not reflective of the historical reality that people actually lived in.
Sorry, I was on mute. So here's another one. So I'm curious, if Mrs. Joyner indeed had an affair and had a child that was not her husband's, clearly if she had an affair with another white man, it would be harder to tell. But if this is the case, it's actually surprising Mr. Joyner allows her to live in this house. Women had much less to say than they do now, and yet Mrs. Joyner still got to keep her. So perhaps this entire unknown history the school is based on is actually better for Priscilla than what is told.
According to Aunt Eliza, the farm that they're living on, the property, was given to the couple when they married as part of Ann Liza's dowry. They came from Ann Liza's father. And again, this was not uncommon either. Women could be property owners. Women could be slaveholders independently of their husbands in the South, in the slave South during the 19th century. So the fact that Ricks, quote unquote, allows Priscilla to live there, he may not have had a choice, right? If the property is actually his wife's. And there are ways that fathers like Ann Liza's father could actually, when they make these bequests to their daughters, they set them up in such a way that, you know, provided that they have sort of a ne'er-do-well husband, like it seems like Ricks might have been, they set them up in such a way that the property remains their daughter's and their husbands are not legally able to sort of do away with it or sell the, you know, the land or enslaved people without their wife's permission. Now, it seems that Ricks did this according to the story that Ann Liza is telling. So if in fact he did sell these enslaved people without her permission, he may be legally liable to her for the value of those enslaved laborers. So what Ann Liza says is she makes a deal with him. She says, I want to keep this baby and raise it in our house as my child or as our child, and you won't owe me that money for those enslaved laborers you sold. That's the story she tells to Priscilla. And according to her, Ricks doesn't really have a choice. He could divorce her for adultery, because the evidence of the adultery is obvious. She has a mixed race child. And if he were to do that, Ann Liza would lose her other children because they would go with the father. And she could also lose Priscilla as well, because since Priscilla is a mixed race child, the state of North Carolina can take the child from her and basically apprentice the child out and as an indentured servant and collect the money for that. And that is also a common practice at the time. So both Ricks and Ann Liza have motivations to stay together, to stay married, and to keep Priscilla in their household. Ann Liza wants to keep her children, wants to keep Priscilla and her other children with her, which if Ricks decides to divorce her, she will not be able to do, most likely. But Ricks also owes her this money, which is not a small amount of money for two enslaved people. It could be, you know, anywhere from several hundred dollars to several thousand dollars, depending on their ages and physical conditions and things like that. So both of them have a motivation to stay together and to try to make this unusual and obviously very painful situation work for them in whatever way. But of course, the person who suffers the most for it is little Priscilla, right? Who is forced to sort of endure the hatred and resentment of Ricks, who then passes that hatred and resentment on to the other children, who then take it out on her, even after he's gone. And he dies in March of 1865, right at the end of the war. And from 1863 to 1865, he's really gone. He's out of the picture. But the children still sort of carry on his mission of making sure Priscilla knows she is not really a part of that family.
All right, we've got two more questions that came in.
Okay.
This is a follow-up from the same person. Also wondering if you would consider writing anything about the Native American and their history, like Salamanca, about an hour south of Buffalo. These are the Seneca people.
Sure, that is a huge part of the history of the Buffalo area in Western New York, and there are lots of people who focus and write on the Seneca. It's not my field of research or expertise, but my colleagues here at the university do that.
Can you go back to the slide about critical race theory?
Okay.
Okay. The first bullet point on your slide about critical race theory can be interpreted in several different ways. What does racist mean? I believe that everyone is aware of race. Does that mean that everyone is racist?
The thing with critical race theory as sort of a field of inquiry, like I said, that arises out of law school, it's really focused on the legal system as it operates, not just the criminal justice system, but, you know, the civil justice system as well. It's not focused on individual racism. It's really focused on how the laws themselves work, even when they're meant to be quote unquote colorblind, and they don't actually, they're not necessarily, if you read some of these laws, they're not talking about what Black people can do, what white people can do. They're not making racial distinctions, but as the laws are implemented in various contexts, whether it's geographical or different time periods, they work to reinforce racial oppression and various forms of discrimination that have existed in many times prior to the laws themselves. So people who, you know, in our, you know, my law school, I'm actually looking out my office window now and I'm looking directly at our law school, people in law schools who write about critical race theory in this way, they're not really focused on individuals. They're not focused on good guys and bad guys. They're focused on how systems of knowledge, systems of the law, kind of shape how people behave, shape how people see each other, and sort of reinscribe our understandings of race and racial differences, often to the disadvantage of people of color, Black and brown people. And so they're really looking at race and racism from a systemic level and not an individual level. Does that make sense?
So Bill, if that clears it up, yes, okay, great. Oh. All right, so there's a follow-up to the previous question. Quick Google shows married women were only allowed to own land starting in 1868, so 3 years after Mr. Joyner died.
That's not true. Certainly not true in North Carolina. Women could individually own land. And if you look in the 1860 census, you will find many, many women who appear as single property women, landowners. Usually they're widows. But sometimes, you know, they're, you know, for whatever reason, they're single women. And they're also single women listed as independent slave owners as well. And you can find that 1860 census, 1850 census. So women could legally own independent property.
Okay. So she says, I specifically look at North Carolina, but Havital, you might have to look in the census for that.
Yeah. So, yeah. So I'm not sure what you're looking at. I'm not, you know, but that is simply not the case, right? Women could independently own land. They could own enslaved property, and they did.
Great. Do we have any other questions? Feel free to raise your hand as well, and I can unmute you. I also do want to mention that we have Carol's book in the library. And it's in surrounding libraries as well. If you want to take it out, we're open till 8 p.m. tonight for another half an hour. Yep, a half an hour if you want to check it out through the reference desk.
And I'll also say, if you're interested in these interviews of ex-slaves, you can find them. They're available online through the Library of Congress. If you Google or look up Born in Slavery, they have PDFs that you can download and read of these interviews, and they're organized generally by state. But there are also hard copies that you can find in some libraries. I'm not sure if the library there in West Hartford will have the hardbound copies in the libraries. They might not. A lot of university libraries will have them. But in any case, you can find them, the PDFs of them, on the Library of Congress. The Virginia narratives or interviews have been anthologized, and you can find that anthology entitled Weevils in the Wheat. And there you will see Priscilla Joyner's full interview, along with many others of her sort of contemporary ex-slave people who were living in and around Virginia at the time.
All right, looks like we have one more question, Carol. Bill, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm looking at the photograph of the people in the critical race theory audience here. This is not a question. It's just a feeling. This sort of thing infuriates me. They wrap themselves in the flag. If you notice, the word education is spelled out in red, white, and blue, as if it's patriotic to put a slash through critical race theory. And then if you look at some of the placards, it says, focus on student achievement, not race. In other words, sweep race under the rug. Content of character over color of skin, Martin Luther King. So they're quoting Martin Luther King so that we can ignore race. I mean, so this is the type of a thing, and the book burning and the book banning just infuriates me. So I'm glad that, you know, I'm glad that you're showing this picture, because it's a picture of what people should not do.
Yeah. Well, I mean, as an educator and a writer, it infuriates me as well. But one of the, you know, things I wanted to sort of make clear is, even though we're sort of going through this moment currently, right, and this is a contemporary picture for us, I wanted to draw that link back to, you know, Eudora Ramsey Richardson, you know, and the folks who, you know, wanted to make sure, you know, she saw herself as a patriotic American and Virginian too, right? And she saw what she was doing and the way she was trying to shape what Priscilla Joyner had to say. She saw that as her patriotic duty. And she, you know, thought that what the Black field workers were trying to do was to sort of indoctrinate people to a particular way of thinking. So even though, you know, we're still, you know, the history repeats itself, right? I hate to sound cliched, but in some ways it does, right? And the things that we're going through have their roots in earlier periods. And always, you know, at the heart of it, you know, are these debates and these arguments about what it means to do history, what is history, and who owns history, and who has the authority to write about it and to say, you know, to say that their version of the past is the only one, the right one, the patriotic one. So yeah, that's a really good point.
And there's just one last comment, Carol. Okay. I now live on John's Island right outside of Charleston. They are doing a 3-week intensive interviewing of descendants of slaves. The Gullah people here have a lot of pull. Lots of study is being done, and I think it's great.
Yeah, I've heard about those projects, and those are really amazing. And Gullah and Geechee culture on the Sea Islands and the coast of South Carolina and Northern Georgia is really rich and a really great way to trace those roots. That's fantastic.
Great. Well, I want to thank you, Carol, so much for coming out tonight. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. I hope everyone has a great night, and definitely check out the book if you get the chance.
Yes. Thank you so much, everyone.
Great. Good night.
Thank you.